First of all, I do want to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which we're running this session and to pay my respects to elders past, present and future. Next, I want to say give 10 seconds of what I'm going to do. It's going to be an example of samples from the workshop, the three-day intensive workshop I run called Demystify Your Thesis. And we run a parallel two-day program for supervisors called Demystifying Thesis Supervision. I'll say a little bit more about that in a minute, but it's deliberately a selection of samples. Now, in the overall Demystify Your Thesis program, there are probably 100 strategies that we cover with the students. I'll give you 10 strategies today. So a sort of a representative sample, some very simple and very, very obvious, others a little bit more pedagogically engaged in terms of the outcomes that we get and their uniqueness, I think. I was asked to make it a practical workshop. When I met with Shelley late last year, and it was Shelley who invited me to come and run the workshop here, and she stressed that it should not be a formal symposium presentation. So it's not going to be a formal symposium presentation. It will be a workshop. I will be looking for a degree of interaction and engagement on your part. A few times I'll be calling for volunteers. If I don't get a volunteer, I'll just say, okay, would you like to come and stand up here? So we've got ways of dealing with that. I was reflecting this morning, looking at the PowerPoints that we're going to look at, and it really struck me how much it is following on from what we've been hearing in the symposium so far. And just going through, I know, looking back at what Tim and Di said yesterday, the absence of a postgraduate voice, the inadequate understanding of the actual student experience and the actual student needs, and the issue of how do we put postgraduate students at the centre of what we do. Then what James was saying about the problem of the smart person syndrome, which relates both to the postgraduate student, but also to the staff, to the supervisor. Not much of an understanding of what we mean by a PhD and a master's in what James called this time of disruption. And clearly there needs to be a recontextualising and a redefining of what we're doing. The need to scaffold the postgraduate research journey. Also, as he pointed out, the need to maintain the highest standards at this time of disruption, at this time of a fairly monumental sort of change that we're going through. That was something that I found really inspiring that Ken Udis picked up a little bit later. What Ali was saying about the rather alarming statistics on how students rate their learning experience in terms of student-staff interaction, active learning, and enriching the educational experience. I was not surprised, but I was appalled by what the stats told us here. What Sally Mail said about negotiating that liminal space preceding the attainment of threshold capability. What does that mean in terms of what we do with students and what students themselves can do to negotiate that liminal space, that sort of in-between space before they acquire that capability, knowing there's a capability there, but they're still on this side of the threshold in terms of knowing how to get from here to there. What Sally Varnum was saying about the challenge of moving beyond treating students as consumers of higher education to significant components within it. And on that, I must say that I think we all need to reflect a little bit about our language, our nomenclature. So many of us yesterday fell into the trap of referring to the university as something outside the staff and the students. And I think that's a mistake that we need to avoid, and we need to empower ourselves to put ourselves back into we are the university. And if we start doing that for ourselves, I think that there's an important flow on for the students also reoccupying that space at the centre of the university. What Ian Studley said about the issue that students might be satisfied, this was in reference to regional uni, he's an undergraduate, students might be satisfied but they're still dropping out. So what can we do to avoid that attrition? Now, it's good that students are happy, but we still don't want them dropping out. And so Well, this really goes to the heart of what I'm attempting to do in demystify your thesis. Then what Ken Uta said with his passionate advocacy yesterday to reclaim the university as a space for public good, with students and faculty at the centre of that space. Then the student panel. I found the student panel yesterday one of the highlights of yesterday's proceedings. And it's been referred to this morning, the absolutely appalling, horrible consequences of poor supervision and the devastating impact it has upon, can have upon students if they're not receiving that support and appropriate supervision. Their sense of disenfranchisement of themselves, of as students as autonomous, creative, graduate researchers. And what this points to is the effective lack of training that we provide our supervisors. Now, I often look around at different universities and I look at, well, what is the provision of training for supervisors? And it's fairly minimal. And we're all aware of the problem that doesn't matter how many workshops we run, the supervisors who tend to turn up are those who probably least need to turn up. And the ones who really need to be improving their practice are the ones who either don't recognise that they need to improve, or they're indifferent to it, or defensive about it. One of the reasons I formulated many, many years ago now the whole demystifying the thesis approach was to address the problem of lack of adequate supervisor preparation to be supervisors. And it suddenly struck me, let's work through the students. Let's empower and equip the students with a set of strategies which are reasonable and necessary for them to take back to the work they do with their supervisor as a way of implicitly giving the supervisor a model of effective supervision. And we're finding that tends to work. Now, coming to today and what Sally Kift was saying, again, I can see points of contact between what I want to do in the next hour and a half or so, and what we've been discussing in the symposium. The need for us to deal with the emotional affective domain as well as a content-based intellectual domain. The issue of personal development and where personal development fits in with the academic development. The need to harness the student's desire to learn. So often I think we operate with a sense of, well, the students don't really have that desire. And so it's either spoon feeding or otherwise we're chastising them. But we need to be able to harness that desire to learn. The issue of people returning to postgraduate studies after some significant gap from their earlier work in higher education. How do we provide that effective transition? People coming back after many years, probably at fairly senior levels in the workforce, do not want to be treated like undergraduate students. So they need to be treated as we should be treating all our students, with respect and with a real commitment on our part to developing them to their full potential. Some of them in terms of capability will be at the beginning here, others will be here. Our job is to move them all, whether they're down here, to move them in on that sort of a trajectory, if they're starting here, to still facilitate their movement on an upward trajectory. She pointed to the effect of disengagement on health and stress and the increasing significant dropout. So again, my strategy is, let's demystify some of the things which we might just take for granted as supervisors, as academic staff. Let's demystify that for the students, so that they can begin to assume greater responsibility for their own research training. Remember what she said about we ignore their desire for learning. So we need to equip them, we need to empower them, so that they can capitalise on that desire that they've already got. I liked the example she gave, that snippet a few minutes ago, the experience of that student being a lone ranger running without the knowledge they need and not knowing where to go to get it. And that resonated with me because I've met so many students in that situation. I'll say that my focus in what I'm going to do is going to be on high degree by research students, masters by research and PhD students, but it's equally applicable to postgraduate students. In fact, I believe it's applicable to undergraduate students. And certainly I have adapted many of the strategies I use with our doctoral students. I've adapted that for when I was working with my kids when they were doing their VCE, year 11 and 12. The same sorts of strategies are applicable there. Talking to my wife, who is a primary school teacher, I can see that many of the strategies I'm using with doctoral students really equivalent to strategies she's using with grade 3, grade 4 students. Okay, I'd point out, as well as a PowerPoint, and that's on your USB that you've all received, as well as a PowerPoint that I'm going to share with you now, I've included, and it's on your USB, a 27-page document elaborating on what the PowerPoint slides are saying. So you'll find far more detail there that you can read in conjunction with going back over the PowerPoints. If people want to stop and question me, I'll have a question time at the end. That's a sort of a thing that I've been told I have to allow for. But please feel free to stop and ask questions or make a comment during our workshop. Okay, just indicate with your hand, and if I don't see you, yell out. Okay. Okay. So, equipping students for postgraduate research. Now, let's see if... Okay, the beginning point is something that we've covered a bit in the symposium. The context for postgraduate research, context for higher education has changed significantly. It's no longer for research students the old master-apprentice model, where a fairly select group of students were very closely, I was going to say mentored, but often they weren't mentored, but very closely worked with often the God professor to be inducted as the next generation of academics. And there are still some places, some people who tend to work with that model. It's a reassuring model to consider, well, I'm a God, but it's not really an applicable model. I recall when I did my PhD back in the 1970s, how relaxed the attitude was to just letting you go off and doing your work. I finished within 3 years because I made a pact with my wife, who was pregnant in 1977, and my 3 years were up on December the 8th, 1977. I said, if I haven't submitted by the time my 3 years is up, I'll make a big bonfire and we'll burn the lot. Because my wife had said to me, I'm not going to hack it. You continuing on with doing your PhD while I'm totally responsible for the baby. So I submitted. I look back at my PhD now, and it was submitted on the 8th of December, 1977. Fortunately, Samuel was born on time on the 12th of December. If it had been premature, I wouldn't have got my PhD. But I did have people I went through with then who literally spent 15 years, sometimes 20 years, completing their PhD. And it really wasn't, there was no sort of accounting or accountability for that. It was generally accepted. But now we're accommodating a larger and a more diverse mix of students, much larger. We're having to accommodate to students whose first language is not English. Who are struggling with both the language and also with cultural issues, who are making different life choices, who are not all aspiring to become academics and to replace us, but who have got different reasons for completing a higher degree by research. Plus, we've also got government insistence now on timely completion. And that's something which has really only happened in the last couple of years. And now, beyond 3.5 years, the pressure's really on to get the student through. Or otherwise, if a department wants to sort of carry that burden, it is the department that carries that burden. We've also got a government insistence, which is appropriate, on providing our research students with a broader skill set than simply completing a thesis. And at Victoria University, a number of other universities, we're using the UK-based research and development framework for defining, ends up about, I think, 76 or so attributes that we're aiming to inculcate into our students. Okay, the context is new, but the aims are, the fundamental aims are basically the same. And I'm thinking back to our colleague, I can't think of his first name, Udap, what's Udap's?
Ken.
What Ken was saying yesterday, that we still have to maintain a commitment to the students making a significant and original contribution to knowledge. That's why they're undertaking a higher degree. Well, that's what it should be. I'm aware that for many of us, that's not the experience. No, the pressure is on us to get students through, to work out often sort of unacceptable shortcuts to get the student over the line within the time frame. And we're forgetting about our obligation, our commitment, our mission to empower the students, to equip them to make that significant contribution to knowledge. The problem is that there are those unprecedented institutional challenges, some of which I mentioned with that last slide, the pressure on time, the pressure on resources, the catering for much larger numbers, and at the same time, the lack of preparedness on the part of so many supervisors to be able to provide adequate supervision. I go back to that point that we really do not take a systematic approach to the preparation of supervisors as supervisors. So the solution, my solution, is to equip students to assume greater control over their own research training, to capitalise on their unique capabilities to complete, to make that significant contribution to knowledge. Now, to do this, we need to be able to do, as I aim to do, to provide them with a strategic framework in which they can operate, with a set, which means a set of strategies, a set of techniques to empower and equip them to take that responsibility for themselves. Now, the demystifying the thesis, I'll talk in a minute, it's not just one program, there are a series of interlocking programs there, but a few things that it's not. It's not a blueprint for how to complete a thesis. And I say that in the very first session of the, you'll recall this, the very first session when the students come to the workshop. If you've come because you want a blueprint of how to complete your thesis, where you just join up the dots, I'm afraid you're going to be disappointed. I hope you'll stay, because often they will change if they do stay. But if that's what you want, that's not what I'm going to give you. And I'm not a replacement for the supervisor. I'm trying to set up a partnership in which, facilitated by me, the student and the supervisor are working together more effectively. Now, what the program is, it is a means to empower students to ask the right sorts of questions of themselves and of their supervisors. They're the ones who are working on a particular original contribution to knowledge. A blueprint is totally inappropriate because it won't cover all these different original projects which are occurring. But they have to know how to ask, well, what are the questions I need to ask? How do I approach what it means to review the literature so that I'm not just summarising, but I'm foregrounding my own work? What does it mean to move from a broad topic to a precise research question? What does it mean to start linking paragraphs when the supervisor says, where's the link, where's the link? What does it mean to have each of the chapters constituting the thesis? And so that is clearly articulated for the examiner. So they need that strategic framework. Then they can arrive at the right kinds of answers, which are appropriate for them and their particular needs. Now, this is equipping the students to capitalise on their own creative energy. And so often the experience of supervision is, I'm not interested in your creative energy, I want you to do this and then this and then this. And some of us have experienced this, and we'll know students have experienced it. When they're told you have to do this and this and this, if after 2 years they discover, well, this is not what I really want to do, this is not what I feel my vocation is, my gift is, they will drop out, or they will completely change the topic, change supervisors, change universities. And that's a waste of resources which we can no longer afford. Now, the third point there is, it is also a model for working productively with their supervisor. And this is where that flow-on effect occurs in terms of providing the supervisor implicitly with an effective model for supervision. If I equip the students with these strategies to deal with what they need to deal with for completing their PhD, if I tell them, okay, the role of your supervisor in terms of helping you with the literature may be this and this. I will take a student, I'm not going to do it now, so don't worry, but I'll take a student in the workshop, and twice during the 3-day workshop, we do a brainstorming in the group so that they can see, well, this is what brainstorming means. This is the role of the questioner and the scribe. And then I suggest to them, see if you can persuade your supervisor to occasionally do these sorts of sessions with you, so that you then are helping the supervisor give you the benefit of their knowledge. Because supervisors are unsure about what to do in terms of supervision. They need models. I was involved in an ALTC project a few years ago with colleagues from 4 other unis, which led to that development of that supervisor toolkit, which is available on the ALT site. And part of that was interviewing some hundreds of colleagues, supervisors, about where they got their ideas for supervision from. And overwhelmingly, it was from their own experience of being supervised. And in about half of the cases, they admitted to, and I had a particularly poor experience of being supervised. And I know that I will never do that because it had such a bad impact on me. I'll never do that with my students, but it's like parents being sort of abused as youngsters tend to reproduce that abuse themselves. So in the absence of other viable models for how to supervise, we all tend to fall back on what we're familiar with. And if we're only familiar with a negative model, that's the model that we're going to reproduce. Oop, what have I done now? The other benefit of taking the demystifying the thesis approach and taking a strategic approach to equipping the students so that we're not simply reliant upon what the supervisor is doing, it provides a sharper institutional focus. Supervisors are aware, I can begin to do things in a different sort of way. We've found at Victoria University, there's then pressure on us in the Graduate Research Centre to provide additional workshops for our colleagues to equip them in this area or this area. It takes the pressure off supervisors to know that, okay, I'm not 100% responsible for what this student is achieving. It's a partnership between me and the student. It makes their job easier. With the models of what they can be doing for different parts of that research journey, it's providing them with effective pedagogical strategies. Their life is better. They are happier people. There's less stress on the part of our colleagues. They can recommit to all the other duties which as academics we're expected to do. Our undergraduate teaching, our administrative work, all the compliance stuff which I find it difficult to cope with. But if I can free up a bit of space in terms of what I'm doing with the same 3 PhD students, that gives me more space to be able to do those other tasks more effectively without burning myself, without grinding myself into the ground. And obviously that's got institutional benefits. Okay, there are 4 programs that make up Demystifying the Thesis. We have a 1-day Beginning the Thesis program, which is for mainly international students who are new to the Australian higher education system. And that is a different sort of program. There's a lot of role playing in that to help them break through their shyness and their embarrassment and their lack of knowledge of what to do. It's a bit traumatic on that one day, but it's better to be a bit traumatic, in my opinion, on that one day than for them never to be able to confront these issues and never be able to suggest to their supervisor what they feel they need from their supervisor, which might continue for years. There's a three-day Demystify Your Thesis, sort of the flagship program, and that's what I'll be talking about today. 3 days, it's an intensive mode generally. We have run it as 9 weekly sessions, but the intensive mode seems to be the more effective. It can be 3 days in a row or 3 days a week apart. That's complemented by that 2-day Demystifying Thesis supervision, in which we get both experienced supervisors and potential supervisors and new supervisors coming in to, in a way, do a parallel program to what we do with the students. And we run a 6-day residential performing the word writing retreat once or twice a year, where we go down usually, last 3 years we've been going down to Queenscliff, a fishing village in Victoria, because I've got a house there, so it's suitable for me. And this is geared to students in the second half of candidature who have got big slabs of writing already done, but are feeling a bit constrained by that thesis style of writing. They want to be able to engage in a more meaningful way with their reader, albeit the reader being an examiner. And so that's a special sort of, appeals mainly, I think, to qualitative humanities, arts, social science students. But we run it in Perth with ECU as well as in Victoria. We've had many other people, many scientists, many engineers, many accountants doing high degrees have also done it. They've been spectacular. The program that we're going to draw from today, it's made up of those 9 sessions. The bolded ones with the asterisk, they're the sessions that I'm going to be drawing the 10 strategies from to give you an indication of what the strategies are. All of these 9 sessions, that's outlined in that document, that 27-page document that you've got on your USB, so you can get a bit more detail about the overall program in there. The first session I'm drawing from is getting the most out of your supervisor. And the little brief advertisement that we send to the students in terms of what they'll do in that first session is, while the thesis is ultimately your product and responsibility, the role of the supervisor for achieving a satisfactory outcome can be critical. And the session provides strategies for you to manage more effectively the student-supervisor relationship. Not leave it to the supervisor. Listen, pal, you need to start doing the managing. You need to start exercising some control in this relationship. It shows the importance of understanding and meeting the supervisor expectations and of balancing your rights and responsibilities as a student vis-a-vis the rights and responsibilities of your supervisor. So the first strategy is a fairly beginning, low-level sort of strategy. I'm going to use this whiteboard for this, and I'm going to call for someone who is a postgraduate student at the moment, research student at the moment, to come and be the volunteer. Have we got someone in the room who is... Yeah, thanks. Could you be the volunteer? Garda, if you sit there. Garda's come for a meeting. I'm her supervisor. Not really, but this is for the purposes of what we're doing. And I've just read her third chapter, draft chapter that she sent me to read. And she is going to play the role of a student at our meeting. And all you have to do for the moment is simply keep nodding as I'm talking to you, right?
As I do.
As you do, as we all do. That's what we do, isn't it? To keep the conversation going. We make that affirmative sort of, yeah, yeah, yeah. Even if we really think, no, no, no. But we say, yeah, yeah, yeah. So all you have to do, you don't actually have to talk. You just have to give me that affirmative nod to keep the things going. Okay, Garda, I'm really impressed with this chapter 3. I think it shows quite a significant advance on what you've been doing, and there's a greater intellectual theoretical depth in terms of how you're approaching this basically ethnographic sort of problem of describing the expectations of Egyptian parents towards their children growing up in Australia. You just keep nodding. But I think, you know, it can be improved, it can be strengthened if you were to introduce Foucault into the discussion. Because this, no, you keep nodding, you want me to keep going? She's doing the right thing, she'd be a good student, or she's an experienced student. But remember, you're pretending you're an inexperienced student and you're not ready to yet confront the supervisor or contest. So what I'd like you to do, I'd like you to consider Foucault, and when we meet in 2 weeks' time, I'd like you to tell me how you've been able to integrate Foucault into your analysis. So if you go off and do that, and I'll see you in 2 weeks. So she stay there because she goes off, goes away for 2 weeks. But when she's been going like that, she really has been, So she goes away. She's never heard of Foucault. So Foucault. So she writes up, Foucault. And she asks herself, what's Foucault? She does, first thing, she goes and does a library search. There's no Foucault. She does a Google search, and she finds that in Hong Kong, there's a food company which is a tea exporting company. She's a bit confused. Now, what has tea exports from Hong Kong got to do with Egyptians' parents' expectations? But Ron's the supervisor, he knows what he's doing. I'll persevere with this, I'll get all the information I can on this tea company. So, comes back in 2 weeks' time. Comes in. Oh, g'day, Garda, I'm good to see you again. And this time you can talk back to me and you can express your confusion. How did you find the suggestion that you integrate Foucault into your analysis?
I actually struggled to find the meaning of the word in the first place, and then I tried to search the library, but I couldn't find any Foucault in the library. And when I searched Google, I found that Foucault was a company that manufactured.
All right, Garda, sorry. I've implicitly misled you. I assumed that you knew what I was talking about when I said Foucault. I was talking about Michel Foucault, a fairly difficult to understand writer. Might be easier in the French, but I haven't read him in the French, but I know people spend years being able to understand Foucault, and then because they've invested so much time understanding it, they become Foucault advocates for the rest of their lives. And I was thinking he's written lots of books. They're really difficult to understand. The book I want you to focus on is called The Birth of the Clinic. Yeah, I assume you knew it because you were nodding. And so from that nod, I assumed that, yep, she follows one. She had not established an honest relationship with the supervisor. On the other side, I had not established that she, in fact, was following what I was saying. What Garda, in fact, did, she crunched up her eyes when I mentioned Foucault at our meeting 2 weeks ago. I should have been sensitive to the body language there. Oh, sorry, have I lost you a bit? You look a little bit confused.
Yeah. Can you explain what Foucault is?
Sure. And then I would have been able to do that. Okay, so there's a need for that sort of transparency and honesty, and that's a simple beginning sort of strategy. Stay there because we're going to move on to strategy number two. Following up on your supervisor's advice, this is strategy number two I give to the students. The parallel strategy for supervisors would be ensuring that the students are following up on what you are advising, on how you are guiding them. So often as supervisors, we tend to forget what we told the student 2, 3, 4 weeks ago. And we do not follow up on, it's bad pedagogical practice, isn't it? But we're busy people. You know, there aren't too many people, I think, working more hours than academics in terms of our diverse workload. So it's natural we forget. But our strategy has to be making sure that we've kept notes of what we've asked the student to do. I ensure this by I put the responsibility on the student. At the end of every meeting, after each meeting, they have to send me an email confirming what we covered that day and what we've both agreed is going to be dealt with at the next meeting. Right, it takes some of the burden off me. It's giving the student the responsibility for their own research training. It's making them manage me. You know, the supervisor-student relationship is too important for the student to just leave to chance. It has to be managed. Now, following up on your supervisor's advice, strategy number two. Stay there for a minute, yeah. Garda goes away. She reads Rabinow's introduction to Foucault. She reads chapter one of The Birth of the Clinic. And she comes back, and because I've kept notes, or she sent me the email of how to follow up, and I say, oh, Garda, how did you find that suggestion of using Foucault? I'll talk for you now. And Garda says, well, you know, I read Rabinow and I can understand what Foucault's position is, his theoretical framework of the relationship between knowledge and power, and I can see what he's saying in The Birth of the Clinic and how exciting that inquiry is, but I've realised that is not the approach I want to take in my thesis, looking at Egyptian parents' expectations of their children. I'm not going to be disappointed. I'm going to be thrilled with that realisation that Garda has made. She has come to that realisation. Contrast that with if Garda had come back and I say, tell me, Garda, how did you find the suggestion of using Foucault? And she says, well, you know, I started to read The Birth of the Clinic and I didn't realise just how difficult it is to read and the size of the words and the length of the sentences. So I thought, no, I haven't got time to spend on that. I am going to be disappointed. I have given her something. I've given her the benefit of my knowledge, my suggestion. I've given her a gift. In return, I expect another gift, as we do when we give a birthday present. I give you a birthday present. He didn't really want it. He's now going to be in the embarrassing position. What happens when it's Ron's birthday? Because he's really now obligated to give me a birthday present. When we give a gift, we are accepting the responsibility to accept something in return. When a person receives a gift, they're accepting the responsibility to give something in return. And I work in Melanesia, by the way, so gift giving and reciprocity is key to life there. So when Garda accepted my suggestion to go and have a look at Foucault, but she's thrown it back in my face, I'm going to be disappointed. I'll try and be empathetic with her situation, but I am going to be disappointed, a little bit frustrated. A little bit of my commitment to her as a person who wants to make a significant contribution to knowledge, that commitment will be diminished. You can sit down now. Thank you very much. One of the things that I give the students some strategic advice about is using the strategy of brainstorming. And a lot of supervisors are averse to brainstorming because partly they don't know what it entails, what it means, but also because it puts them in the spotlight that often they don't want to occupy. But if the student has been introduced to that because they've been to my workshop and they go to their supervisor at this point where they say, well, I've realised that this is not the approach I want to take, they will have rehearsed in Demystify Your Thesis. The statement, the rehearsed bit is, oh, do you think we could possibly brainstorm a bit what the other approaches might be that I could take? So that is managing the supervisor. Now, as a supervisor, sure, even if I'm not really feeling very adept at brainstorming, I'll say, sure, we'll talk about it. I have in my office, you'll know this, you've seen inside my office, a much bigger whiteboard than this. I use a whiteboard all the time, and I use it for brainstorming. So I get a student in, I use brainstorming a hell of a lot to help them structurally work out what it is they need to do next, and you can do that best diagrammatically. But if I brainstorm with Garda or I brainstorm with a student in terms of, well, what other approaches have you considered? Have you considered, for instance, and you will say, you've considered that, but you didn't find that useful. Was there any part of it which you did find useful? Well, I was really interested in this aspect. I thought that might be fruitful. Well, and I'll note that on the whiteboard. Let's consider that a little bit more. Do you know of any other studies which have used that approach that you might be able to have a look at? Oh, I read one, but I can't remember what it is. We write down on the whiteboard a gap. Okay, before we meet in a fortnight's time, I want you to find that and any other literature dealing with that sort of approach. Because it sounds like that there's a bit of an inkling here that this might be a suitable approach for you to be taking. And she is the one who is nominating that approach. I'm not telling her what to do. I am facilitating her being able to do something with, referring back to Sally's comment this morning, with her desire to learn. I am building on her desire.
What happens when you come up with an approach and your supervisor doesn't want to go there because it's not an area they're comfortable with, or they're not sure that it's not something the field's used to?
Okay. I treat that as a student. I say to a student, and it's a common problem, I say to a student, treat that as an opportunity.
Well, you're the student doing it and the supervisor saying no.
Yep. Still treat it as an opportunity. The task then for the student is to persuade the supervisor as to why this is an appropriate and feasible approach to the problem. Treat the supervisor as like their first examiner. I have to be able to persuade a skeptic here as to the reasons for my approach. And it may be that the student has never given any attention to that sort of issue. How do I justify my decision here, my choice here? And it can't be a justification in terms of, I am using this approach because my supervisor wants me to, or I am using this approach because this authority and this authority use it. They'd have to say, I am using this approach because this authority and this authority has shown that it's a way of arriving at valid and reliable results. Now they're talking in terms of justification. And when they start talking in those terms, they're talking the language that supervisors will tend to respond to positively. It goes back to there is a breakdown in communication here. And there isn't a, this is why I would love to run the Demystify Your Thesis workshops where we've got the supervisor and the student both attending. Okay, it's been impossible, logistically impossible so far. But if we could manage that, I think that would be brilliant. And it's a way of dealing with that sort of an issue. Now, the student is now in a position to be able to start thinking strategically about, well, if that's not my approach, what are the approaches? And as we can see, or as I've argued, that gives scope for the supervisor to play a role. The supervisor can now supervise. Now, a lot of what passes for supervision isn't actually supervision. It's sort of frittering away time. Now, so many students approach me and they complain that session after session after session with their supervisor, they do not appear to be moving forward. They seem to be covering the same sort of ground. So they need strategies to be able to make the supervisor feel comfortable about being taken outside her comfort zone. The same time the student needs to be prepared to go outside her comfort zone. That goes to the issue that Sally was talking about this morning. We need to pay attention to that emotional, affective side of what's occurring with a postgraduate student as well. How do we equip them to be able to feel confident to say what might be a contesting what the supervisor's saying? I don't diminish how big a problem that is, but even to recognise it as a problem and to start talking about it and to encourage the student to start talking about it with their supervisor is a big move forward. And so if a student comes and sees me and they've got another supervisor and they're confronting this, I'd be suggesting things along the lines of, well, let's rehearse a few lines that you might use. Now, you say you feel really uncomfortable. Perhaps you need to say that to your supervisor. Oh, I feel really uncomfortable in even bringing this up, but what you're expecting me to do here, it's not what I want to do. If they have rehearsed what they can say beforehand, they can go into that meeting and they can get it out. For some of them, I say, write it on a piece of paper. You've got 3 dot points that you want to cover, and you don't even have to look at your supervisor. You can explain, I can't look at you because I feel so sort of, oh, just embarrassed about even talking to you in this way, but I need to say, dirt, dirt, dirt. And that's a big breakthrough for a student. And I'd add a big breakthrough for the supervisor, who is often not recognised, I am dealing with a real person here. Often it's just, oh, I knew a guy who was a professor of economics at La Trobe, and he used to boast how he had 12 PhD students, 12 full-time PhD students, and he dealt with all of them on a Monday morning. He had his PA outside, and she had them sort of all sitting there. One would come in after the other. And he said this proudly. I was appalled. I didn't say to him, oh, this is dreadful, but I was appalled. It was a production line like a biscuit sort of factory, how these students were being treated. And then he admitted, of course, it creates a lot of work for me towards the end because I have to rewrite everything they say. So he has not equipped those students to be independent researchers at all. He thinks he's doing a good job. He's getting the students through, but they haven't gone from here to here, and he's taken on this responsibility of working himself into the grave, a recipe for disaster on all counts. Also, it's a recipe for disaster at an institutional level. Imagine if some newspaper reporters got hold of that story, what they could make of that in terms of the reputation of the university, allowing a senior professor to be able to redraft all of his students' work so that it passes. The next strategy is taken from a session called What is a Thesis? I point out there a thesis can mean many different things. It does vary depending on the field of research, depending on the discipline. But I point out to the students, because remember I'm drawing them from all disciplines, that there are some common features that it's useful for us to talk about, that any discipline will expect. So let's talk a little bit about what is a thesis in terms of whether you're a social science student or an engineering student or an education student. And here I'm referring to thesis in two senses, which I point out to the students. If I say to you, you can pretend you're a student, okay, can you run down to the library now? We have all these sessions in a room called P134, which is in the library building, so I can actually send you out upstairs. Go into the library and come back with a thesis with you, relevant to your area of research. He'll be away for 5 minutes, we can do something else. He comes back and he's holding there a 300-page bound document, puts it down, here's a thesis. And I point out, this has got real form, hasn't it? This is a material artifact. 300 pages, stiff binding, all these lines on it. We call that a thesis, but there's also a thesis in terms of what's inside this artifact, the argument. So I'm talking to them about thesis as artifact, the dissertation, and thesis as argument. And it's a fairly obvious sort of distinction, but a lot of people, including supervisors, are confused on that. And they either over-focus on thesis as argument and forget about, well, this has to be communicated, presented, expressed in a clear way, which is going to convey what the student is trying to say to the examiner, or otherwise they place too much emphasis on the style, on how well it is written, and don't emphasise the need for there to be a continuing argument, which is, for instance, linking all of the chapters. Okay, so I'm talking about thesis in both those senses. The third strategy is using theory to link evidence and thesis. Theory is an area that a lot of students have difficulty with and a lot of us as academics have difficulty with. I'm convinced that it's partly because a lot of people who write in an explicitly theoretical way write pretty badly. Right, you have to read what they write 5 times if you can grasp their meaning. They have sentences which run on for half a page. They use the most, the biggest words they can find. They use nominalisation a lot rather than active voice. It's almost as if they're thinking, well, if someone reads this and they can understand it on the first reading, I've failed. I say, well, really, it's just an example of poor writing. And I say to the students, as you're obliged to do in terms of the instructions we send out to examiners, they were obliged to be able to theoretically locate their work. I said, but don't reproduce the way that some of these other writers have used theory. It might sound impressive, but it really doesn't say all that much. It doesn't convey enough. So I suggest to them, I want to show them how we can view theory as the mechanism by which we link the evidence with the argument, the evidence with the thesis. I give them 2 scenarios. And these are very simplistic scenarios, right? But I'm trying to make the pedagogical point rather than to persuade them at that content sort of level. I have them imagine that they're writing a thesis on female workers in the Thai silk industry. And the thesis is, to what extent has the position of women workers in the Thai silk industry improved over the last 10 years? That's what they're investigating. That's their research question. So they go out and they collect all the evidence. They go over, do a bit of field work in Bangkok, and they collect a lot of evidence over the internet here. And they get all this data on hours worked, how regular the work is, how secure the employment is, whether there's childcare provision at the factories, whether the women are playing any role in the trade unions, what their wage rates are, whether management gives them the opportunity to contribute to decisions within the factory, and so on. That's the evidence. Then I point out, depending upon the theoretical framework that they apply to that body of evidence, they're going to come up with a different argument, a different thesis. If they take a Marxist, and there are some re-emerging neo-Marxist analysts, if they take a Marxist position, in fact, I think I warm to this position in Australia today, that when we look at the influence that one can exert in society, and here we really are talking about influence, we're talking about the influence of women in the Thai silk industry. A Marxist theoretical position would be that we need to consider the relationship of the person to the means of production. Now, the classic sort of Marxist maxim. The greater one's ownership and control of the means of production, the greater one's influence. And from that, you'll know that Marx envisaged only really two classes in society, those who own and control the means of production and those who have got nothing but their labour capacity to sell in order to survive. Now, according to that theoretical position, there's no way that the position of women in the Thai silk industry could have improved significantly over the last decade, or men, or male workers for that matter, because their ownership and control of the silk industry, that factory, has not increased. Unless perhaps they're being given as an incentive shares in the company, which muddies the water a little bit, because if you become a shareholder, to a little extent you become an owner of the means of production. But the alternative theory is from Max Weber, and Max Weber argued, contra Marx, that when we look at why some people can influence, have greater influence in society than others, we need to consider three factors. We need to consider their class, and he doesn't use class like Marx does, he really means income there. We need to consider their status, and we need to consider their power. And the distinction he makes there, let's all imagine we are all parents of children at a local primary school. And all of us are accountants in this room. We're all on $65,000 a year. So in terms of income and in terms of status, we're all equal. None of us is more influential than anyone else. But Garda's a person who's prepared to get up there and become a spokesperson for the rest of us. She puts herself up to serve on the school council. So she joins a Parents, Friends and Teachers Association, whatever it might be called, on the school. Now, Bill here, he's just an ordinary parent, right? An accountant parent. He's got a bit of a problem. He wants to talk to the school principal. He kicks up the phone. Oh, sorry, the principal hasn't got time to talk to you. Bill Eckersley, no, he's just another parent. He haven't got time to talk to him. When Garda picks up the phone, she needs to talk to the school principal, she'll be put through because she's on the school council. Even in that very minor way, she has got greater power than the rest of us. She can exert more influence. Now this is, as I say, it's a very simple, almost simplistic model, but it's a way that the students can grasp how we work with theory. And when we apply that theoretical framework as opposed to the Marxist theoretical framework, we come up with a different thesis. That is, when we look at their increased hours, they've now got a say in the trade union, their wage rates have been going up, we can say, yes, their position has improved to this extent or this extent. Now, of course, if you're writing a thesis, you could incorporate both those theoretical frameworks. You could outline what all the evidence is, what the data you've generated, and then you could point out to the examiner that depending upon the theoretical framework by which you interrogate that data, you'll come up with different sorts of conclusions. So the student doesn't have to make a commitment to a particular theory, but they have to understand what the role of theory is, how theory works, and then apply that model to their own sphere. The other example I give is Julie Stevens, a colleague of ours in the Faculty of Arts, gave me this example. And there, the focus is on sex industry workers, right? Prostitutes in the legal business, right? Not just the street walkers. The evidence, you go out and you interview women working in the legal sex industry, you read through the various pamphlets, you read through their memoir and confessional narratives, you look at the public health records and research, you look at legal and police data, there's a whole body of evidence you could draw from there. And then, depending upon which theoretical framework you apply, you're going to arrive at a different argument, a different thesis. If you adopt a liberal feminist perspective, that sex is just another kind of work, if you adopt that perspective, right, and treat it like women working in the factory, women working in management, you'll come up with a thesis that women have freely chosen to work in this legal industry and their experiences are potentially empowering. Like the experiences of academics are potentially empowering. They won't be empowering for everyone, but they're potentially empowering. Like the experiences of parenthood are potentially empowering. But if you take a radical feminist perspective of anti-prostitution feminists who are supporting, as we find in Sweden, as Julian Assange found out in Sweden, supporting criminalisation of buying of sexual services, and who view the legal industry as coercive, exploitative and violent, we come up with a different argument. The argument now will be along the lines that women in the industry do not freely choose to work there and their experiences are potentially harmful. Again, a student writing a thesis around this area would not have to sign up to one or other of these theoretical perspectives, but they need to be able to recognise that different theoretical frameworks will lead to a different interpretation of the same body of evidence. Okay, so that's the point. That's why it's strategic. It's a strategy that students can now grasp. Oh, that's what the purpose of theory is. Now when I go back and I read things in the area that I'm working in, I know now what I'm even looking for. What sort of interpretative framework is a person applying to the evidence to arrive at the sorts of conclusions they make? And what I say to supervisors is, okay, these are two examples in an area that I feel comfortable with, right, the sort of social science area. Your task, your job now is to find equivalent sorts of examples or exemplars from your discipline to give to your student to enable them to understand how theory works in your discipline. Okay, the next strategy is from the session on developing a research question. And as you can see there, I note one of the first steps in a successful research project in any discipline is the crafting of a clear and concise research question. Now, I'll put a caveat in there. Of course, we also know that the research question comes out of the way the student is interrogating the literature. What comes first? It's a chicken and an egg. You don't even know what literature to read until you've got a sense of what it is you're going to research. But you're not really getting a detailed sense of what it is you're researching until you're more familiar with the literature. So it's an iterative process that probably lasts the first 2 years of a 3-year project, and that the research question will undergo modification and refinement during that time. But I argue that the research question should be developed early in the life of the project because much of the project design and the candidature proposal, which our students do 6 months or 6 to 9 months after enrolling, will be based upon it. And then what I provide in the session with them is a framework for arriving at a research question that encapsulates the essence of the work in relatively few words. So here the strategy is how to move from a broad topic to a precise research question. And here I'm drawing from the social science model. Now, it's not on the PowerPoint that you've got, and it's not on this PowerPoint, but in the accompanying notes, I've got another slide there in the notes of the typical science model, which is different from this, right? But I'm talking about the social science model. This is based on a real PhD, which was done some years ago by a psychology student at Victoria University who wanted to look at how people cope with chronic illness, right? The psychosocial sort of adjustment that needs to be made by finding out that you're suffering from a chronic illness. I want you to imagine here, and in the notes that you've got on your USB, all of these lines have got a footnote, and you can see at the bottom of the page with how the supervisors work through this iterative process with the student and what it means. Student comes along, meets a supervisor who's going to supervise her, says, I'm really passionate about understanding how people cope with chronic illness. What sorts of psychosocial adjustments do they need to make to being able to live with a chronic illness? Hold on, the supervisor would say. You could have a World Health Organization expert panel of 50 people looking at responses to chronic illness. They could do that for 20 years and still only be scratching the surface. No way can you manage that in a PhD thesis. We have to reduce it. We have to refine it. I want you to go off and I want you to look at the literature and find a chronic illness where more research needs to be done, where there's a gap, where we don't know much about what the psychosocial adjustment has been. Because a chronic illness could be HIV/AIDS, it could be tuberculosis, it could be hepatitis, it could be Parkinson's, it could be any number. In this case, it's Huntington's, Huntington's chorea or Huntington's disease. Some of you will be aware it's passed on genetically. It affects, on average, 50% of the offspring. It doesn't manifest itself until you're typically around about 30 or 40. It might be some early signs, but then the symptoms really cut in then. And then the progression is usually fairly sharp and swift, and there's never a good outcome, right? Never a good outcome. So it's a horrific disease. Very little research is done on it because drug companies, they've got no real incentive to research it. In America, there are 50,000 sufferers from Huntington's compared with, 3 million sufferers of something else where there's a bigger market. So she goes off, she does her reading, she comes up with, Huntington's disease is a bit of a goer. But then the problem is still, well, you still need to narrow it down further. And you've got some choices here. You could, for instance, be looking at recently diagnosed people who just got their diagnosis from the doctor, sufferers with the early signs, sufferers with a developed illness, or you could also look at their carers and their family, because they also have to make a psychosocial adjustment to living with a chronic illness. Well, we can rule this one out because the student is hell-bent on actually looking at how the people suffering, diagnosed, how they are coping. We can rule this one out. That one would never, ever get any university ethics committee approval. They're not going to let a student loose on people who are confronting death, who are dealing with behaviour which is both mystifying to them and highly distressing. And the reality is, over 4 years, you'll probably lose some of your subjects who will already died or become unable to communicate with you. So really, the choice is between recently diagnosed people or sufferers with early signs. Now the student, with the supervisor's encouragement, will be thinking about, well, think a little bit about your methods here, your methodology. Are you planning to use interviews or surveys, or are you going to go and talk with doctors? Start giving a little bit of flesh to how you're going to answer the question that you're going to pose, because that'll in part determine what your final research question is. You have to be able to generate data, and to generate data you have to have some methods for generating the data. So you have to be thinking about that as well as thinking about refining your research question. So this might occur over about 3 months, say. Typically during that really intensive reading stage at the beginning of candidature or after enrolment, when the student is trying to become familiar with as large a body of the literature as possible. They're getting a sense of what the literary landscape is for their particular research project. So they come up with a much more refined topic now. They're going to look at psychosocial adjustment to Huntington's by sufferers with early signs of the disease. Now, what I insist with my students, and I recommend to other supervisors that they do the same, is to turn that into a question. An open question, that is, one which can't be answered with a simple yes or no, because that's a dead-end question. So an open question like, what are the variables determining why some people adjust well and others do not adjust well to being diagnosed with Huntington's disease? Now, when you pose a question like that, it's beginning to give the student a sense of the structure of their research. Because to answer that question, you have to, first of all, indicate how they responded. That's the descriptive side. Well, there are all these different responses. Some people go to the pack. Some people find God. Some people give up God. Some people become preoccupied with the financial stability of their family. Some people turn to alcohol. Some people become really sort of self-destructive in their behaviour. Some people, we had a fight 30 years ago, you and I, and now I know my time is limited, I want to sort of reconcile now. Some people will do that when they're confronting the reality of their life. So, the student knows that, yep, I'm going to have to, first of all, document what the ranges of responses are. But then I'm going to have to say why different people respond in different ways. And that's where the creative power of the student, aided by the supervisor, comes to the fore. At this point, they're only limited by their own creative imagination. They have to begin to imagine, well, how might I explain these different responses that I've described? And again, a brainstorming session with a supervisor is a really useful tactic here. Well, what might be the factors? Well, maybe whether it's or not you've got a religious conviction. Maybe another factor is your level of financial security. Another factor might be your level of education. Another factor might be whether or not you live in an intact family. Another factor might be how the diagnosing doctor actually told you about your condition. Another factor might be which suburb of Melbourne you live in. Because some suburbs of Melbourne, there's really great nursing and palliative care, which is going to be important in a few years' time for these people. In other suburbs, there's no provision. So all of these might be factors. Already you can start imagining now some of the recommendations which might come out of this particular research in terms of those municipalities which provide care, and if you can demonstrate that that has a positive impact on coping with this knowledge compared with those municipalities which don't. But the student can begin to see now how a structure is emerging by posing that sort of a question. So we've moved from a broad topic down to a precise research question, which is now providing a framework, a structure for the student to continue with their research. They might decide, okay, I'm going to go out and interview these people. Right? It's forced them to make a commitment or to sort of say, yes, this is going to be one of my methods. As a supervisor, my first question to them will be, how equipped are you to undertake interviews? And are you aware that there's a big literature on different ways of interviewing, which leads to quite different sorts of results in terms of the data you generate? And I'd recommend go and read Catherine Reisman's book, Narrative in the Human Sciences, I think, Narrative in the Human Sciences, where she looks at different ways of interviewing, like dialogical framework compared with a reporting framework, compared with something else, compared with something else, and how that leads to fundamentally different understandings based on what the person is telling you. So, as a supervisor, again, by thinking strategically, well, okay, student says they're going to use this method, and this method. Let me find out how equipped they are to use those methods and if they've considered ways of enhancing what they're proposing to do. Now, I'm being a real supervisor. I'm not making these decisions for the student. I'm not working any harder. I'm just thinking a little bit more strategically. And this is what good supervision is. We're talking here about a negotiated agreement between the supervisor and the student. Right, it's not a one-way process, it is a two-way process. And as well as looking at the beginning capacity and the potential of the student to actually complete that research, we also have to look at the beginning capacity in the interest of the supervisor. The two, at some critical point, have to match. They have to dovetail in. Because if they don't dovetail in, there isn't going to be that productive relationship, which is necessary for resulting in a really great contribution to knowledge. So all I say is, yep, you're absolutely right, I concur with that. Remember, I was saying that that process also was occurring over a number of months. So it's not just going into one or two meetings and quickly coming up with how we're going to deal with this. Right, it is giving options all the time to the student. And often the student will come up with an approach which is totally outside my imagination. Of course you can do it that way. Yeah, I didn't realise that, but yeah, that sounds great. Tell me a bit more about that. Okay, the literature review, when to start and when to stop. Many students, the first thing we tell them, isn't it, when we get a new student, go and become familiar with all the relevant literature. Right, so they go away and they studiously read everything. Often we omit to tell them why you read the literature, which is to position your new knowledge that you're creating. The new knowledge which they're creating through their research, where does that fit in with existing knowledge? Often we don't make the simple connection to the student that all this literature represents what we know about the area. Knowledge isn't something that's floating around in the air and all you have to do is sort of look up to heaven and turn your head a little bit to the side and the knowledge is going to go through the nearest orifice. It doesn't work that way. You read the literature because that's what we know. The literature here are the books, the articles, other theses, conference presentations, seminars, government data. That constitutes the literature. That's where the knowledge is. And it's a very simple message to give to the students, but it can be profoundly transformative for the students. Oh, that's why I'm reading the literature. Many of the students I come across treat the literature like they're in a readathon at primary school. They get a dollar for every new book they read. Well, I'm not going to give you a dollar for every article you read. No, you're reading for this purpose. So that's a beginning point that the student needs to understand that this is the point of why I'm doing this reading. And this is also, when they approach it that way, when they come to writing their literature review, it's going to be different from what so many literature reviews are, which so many examiners complain about, which is simply a summary of who said what when. The examiners know that. They want to know where the student's work fits in with what's already been done. This is encouraging the students to think about where they're going to make their original contribution. It's encouraging them to be analytical and critical in their reading. As we'll see in a minute, asking some questions, which is going to enable them to treat the literature in a more critical way. So this strategy I give them is reviewing the literature to show how they are building on, but also going beyond what others have written. And I use a four-step strategy, and it's there are quite a few pages on it in those notes that you can look at on your USB stick. The first step is for them to summarise what it is the author has written. By using the same categories for each article, for each book chapter, the ones that I use, which are relevant for me, what is the scope of the inquiry, or what is the central issue? I say to them, listen, by and large, unless it's fairly poorly written, any article you read is going to be dealing with a central issue. Often it's articulated in the abstract. So read the abstract carefully first, and then look carefully at the introductory paragraph of the article. Often it will be made clear there, this article, this research is dealing with this issue. And they can do that for each text they're reading. Let's imagine over the course of a year they read 100 texts. They're using this template systematically, and by the way, we teach this, give this template to our commencing students in our new PhD integrated. And I had our librarian, Cameron Barry, who came in a couple of weeks ago, and he showed the students how they can do all of this in EndNote, because that's the preferred bibliographical software we use at VU. So they don't have to do, I do it manually. I actually have a Word document that I add to, and then I'll do a Word search ultimately, but they can get EndNote to do it for them. If anyone's interested in that, I can send them the few pages on how to do this in EndNote. Okay, so the central issue for every text you're reading, what's the scope of the inquiry? Women in Nepal being interviewed? Or is it people living in cities? Or it's an educational issue? Or is it focusing on teachers' responses or children's responses or test results or parent attitudes? What's the time frame? What is the scope of the inquiry? What's the methodology? What are the methods? How are they actually setting about answering the question that they've posed for this article? Based on interviews or surveys, statistical analysis, multivariate analysis, what are the methods there? And often there, what are the theories informing the methods? I say to them as they start filling out the template, don't expect you're going to fill in every square. There'll be many, 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 probably most articles you read, the author's not going to say, the theory informing my approach to this problem is such and such. It might be a year later when the penny suddenly drops and, oh, that was a theoretical framework that person was working with. I didn't realise it at the time because they didn't state it, but now I can see, yep, that was a theoretical framework. With this template approach, they can go back and they can add that in later. And what are the findings? What are the findings coming out of the research which have been carried out? And all of this, only one or two dot points for each of these, right? I don't want them sort of reproducing the article. It's like an aide memoir to themselves of what was covered here. Now imagine they do this for 100 articles. I say 100 because we can turn it into a percentage. When they look through, there are 100 articles dealing around the topic they're working with. They can now go and by the categories that they've used, and I ask them to try to be consistent. try to, when you're talking about the scope and the methodology, try to use the same words. Don't come up with a different way of describing the same thing. Be consistent throughout each of your texts. By reviewing these 100 sheets of paper, or getting what's in EndNote, they can see that 55 of their 100 authors, 55%, are using this particular methodological approach. 25 are using this approach. Only 2 are using a critical feminist approach. Same with the sorts of issues which are being discussed in the literature around that topic area. The same with the scope. Well, all of the research is really focusing on women in developed countries or women in cities. They can look at the sort of data that's generated by these different approaches. Same with the theory. Now, they're the first one, because no one else is doing their particular thesis. No one else has read these same 100 articles to inform their thesis. When they discover that 55% are using this particular methodological approach, how impressive is that going to be to an examiner that they can state, on the basis of their reading, comprehensive review of the literature, more than half of researchers working in this area are taking this approach? They're not now simply summarising, they're generalising, they're looking at what the exceptions are. Only 2% are taking a critical feminist approach. This is also pointing them to where there might be a gap for them to use. That was step one, which is really, and if we've got students, some of the science areas, the students are obliged to do a systematic literature review, right? This is one way that they can start collating the information for their systematic literature review, so that when they write up, they can not just repeat in a serial fashion everything that's been written, but they can start making some more general observations about the overall patterns, about what constitutes the conversation in this area. Step two is, they ask themselves, how am I borrowing, how am I building on what's already been written? We don't want them to slip into potential plagiarism. It's a requirement that they honestly acknowledge previous work. They'll also find out, oh shit, I wish that that person hadn't written that, because I thought that was a new idea of mine, but now I'm going to have to acknowledge it. But that still is a requirement. And they do that in terms of the issue, the scope, the methodology, the data, and the theory. Third step, and they're all related, how am I going beyond? How am I doing something different from what all these other authors have done? Right, I've shown how I'm sort of carrying on certain traditions, but how am I breaking those traditions? And often, it'll be in terms of mixing and matching. They might be looking at similar issues to these 5 people, but they'll be scoping it differently than other people have scoped, but with a different issue. They'll be using methods that other people have used, but the people who have looked at the same issue haven't used. Same with the theory. So by being able to show how they are approaching their particular issue, and how, yes, they are borrowing from, but now they're doing it in a different sort of way. What they're doing in terms of combining the issue, the scope, the methodology, the data and the theory, they're providing us with a new insight into this particular problem. Finally, step 4, I ask them, okay, it has to be significant and important why you are taking the approach you're taking, why you are looking at this issue, why you're using this set of methods. I point out to them my rat's tail example. I draw a picture of a rat on the board. It's a highly impressionistic rat, but we'll make it a happy rat. I say to them, you know, if you want to do something really original that no one else has done before, if you want to make a name for yourself that no one else has looked at this topic before, you know, no one has done any research into the hairs on the last third of a rat's tail. Believe me, go and you do a good Google Scholar search. I bet you a dozen bottles of wine that you won't find another piece of serious research looking at the hairs on the last third of a rat's tail. And why not? Because do we really need that knowledge? No. Well, you can imagine there might be some genetic differences between the hairs on the last third of a rat's tail which provide us with important knowledge. In that case, yes, it would be significant. Or my mother-in-law is a botanic artist and she's always looking for brushes with the finest hairs to do the little sort of veins on leaves and things. She might be interested in the hairs on the last third of a rat's tail, but for most of us, it's not going to be an important, significant topic which is going to warrant 4 years of investigation. So you also have to make a case for why what you're doing is important and significant. And what, this is one of the criteria that examiners examine, isn't it? The importance and significance. And that it's not just sort of, it can't just be implied there. The students have to make a case. They have to make it explicit. The next strategy is taken from the architecture of a thesis. And it's making most use of a chapter's introductory and concluding paragraphs. And I say to the students, I give them some examples. I work with a master's thesis and a PhD thesis, and I'll share one of them with you, or two perhaps. I say, when we look at the introductory paragraph to one of your chapters, potentially there are four functions that introductory paragraph can serve. It can show the relationship, and here I'll bring this in now because I drew this up before. Can you, you might have trouble seeing that, I'll move back a fraction. Okay. There's a chapter that they're working on. We're talking about this introductory paragraph here. The functions are, the introductory paragraph can show the relationship of what we're about to read to the thesis. It can signpost what we're going to read in the, I think I press. The relationship to the thesis, signposting what this block of text is going to cover. I ask them, I'll do it for you in 1 minute, but this is about 10 minutes working with the students. I say, what came before this first paragraph? And they struggle a bit, but they eventually get, oh, there's a paragraph of the previous chapter. Well, it'll be a good idea, won't it, in terms of giving a sense of continuity, to have it segueing, linking with where that chapter finished off. And also, what comes after this introductory paragraph? Ooh, chapter 5? No. Immediately after. Ah, paragraph number 2. So let's consider at the end of this paragraph how we set up the link for the next paragraph. When we come to the concluding paragraph, it's the same, but it's sort of mirrored. An opportunity to reiterate what this chapter has shown and its relationship to the overall argument, to the thesis, just to make sure that the reader, by the time they get there, and it might be an examiner who sort of fell asleep or got drunk or went away to write a conference paper and then comes back, picks up their reading here, can't remember what they've read, you just want to remind them. So you reiterate what this chapter has shown, that's function 2. What came before that was paragraph number 35. So it'd be rather neat in terms of continuity within the chapter if we can show a link between the end of this paragraph and the beginning of this chapter. And what comes next is chapter 5. So let's set up the link so that when the reader starts reading chapter 5, oh yeah, I can see how this follows on. Gives a profound sense of continuity. And what that means for the reader is that there's a confidence that there is, in fact, a logical sort of development occurring here. Same with the concluding paragraph, I covered that. Now, this is one of the examples I give to the students, and I show this doesn't have to be all that complicated. It can be a few little linguistic clues to alert the reader to how you're doing these things. The preceding chapter suggested, right, that's why, oh yeah, that's a link. I see how this follows on from what was previously done. Then we move into what this chapter is going to cover. Just to make sure, in case we've got an examiner who really is heavily on the bottle, that they've missed that, we immediately say, as this chapter indicates. Right, so that when the examiner, oh, what am I going to be reading about in this chapter? Oh, as this chapter indicates. We're giving them a bit of a clue, a bit of help. And as this chapter argues, and that is what relates it to the overall thesis, right? So we'd spend maybe 10 minutes going through that. In the concluding paragraph, and I do use the concluding paragraph for the same chapter, same sort of thing. By focusing on the notion of possession, which is what we've just been dealing with in the previous few paragraphs, practitioners are introduced, reiterating what we've seen overall in this chapter has shown such and such, moving into how we're going to build upon that and move into a different aspect in the next chapter. The following chapter focuses on more familiar, that is, more familiar than what we dealt with in this chapter. And finally, it's reiterating what the relationship is between what we've just read, the 40 paragraphs we've just read, and the overall thesis. So it's mainly those linguistic clues, which is what they have to master, in order to be able to persuade the examiner. Remember, all of this PowerPoint is on your USB stick as well. Okay. The next strategy is using concluding and introductory paragraphs to link chapters. There we go through the same sort of thing. I won't spend time on it now. You can see you've got the PowerPoint there, but it's also elaborated on in the accompanying notes. But here we're moving from the final paragraph of one chapter and then how that is picked up in the following chapter to show that continuity between chapters. So within chapters and between chapters. There's another strategy around this architecture business, using the series of paragraph introductory paragraphs to draft your thesis introduction. This is a neat trick. If the students have followed something like this model for how they write their introductory paragraphs, we're going to have a statement of what each chapter covers. So if they do a copy and paste and they copy each of their introductory paragraphs, might be, say, eight substantive introductory paragraphs, copy and paste that into one document, there's a first cut of what they need to say in their introduction to the thesis. Because remember, it's not only told us, according to this model, what's in each chapter, it's already drawn the connection with the thesis overall. And they're doing both those things in their introduction. You can read more about that as well in the notes. Strategy 9 is linking paragraphs for continuity and flow. And in your in the notes that you've got on your USB stick, I've included this article here, which is made up of 36 paragraphs, and it's the one we use in the workshop. And I have drawn in the links for the first 18 paragraphs to show how each of those paragraphs is linked. The remaining 18, it's left blank, and so we have a group exercise or a small group exercise in the workshop where the students work together to try and work out what the links are. The next step then is for them then to apply that same strategy to their writing, to go back to their writing. Now, some students have not been shown that simple process writing way of linking paragraphs, and they're going to feel awkward. They're going to struggle a bit. I reassure them, it doesn't say anything about your intelligence. It says something about the schooling you receive when you're in year 8 and year 9. So we're just going to go back and we're going to have a strategy here that really your teacher should have been telling you, 12 years ago. And so if you're not familiar with how to link paragraphs, when you go back and you try and write these paragraphs into your own work, you're going to find it probably a clumsy sort of exercise. It might take you an hour to work out how you can possibly link, because you're going to have to change the wording a bit. But after you've done that for 2 weeks, believe me, I say to them, and it's true, you start then writing from scratch, already writing the links in. It's that quick. And the feedback I get from the students is, yes, it is that quick. And I can see that when I subsequently get emails from them. The email paragraphs are neatly linked. And they go back and they insert the first paragraph of their email really sort of captures what the rest of the paragraphs are going to say. So it's a transferable skill that they're going to be able to use. They don't have to become an academic to use this skill, but they'll all be writing reports, writing a memo for the CEO, whatever it might be. So this is a really important transferable skill, which goes to the heart of being able to express and to communicate effectively, and to be able to persuade a reader to your point of view so they can understand what you're saying. The examples I give, that it's on the PowerPoint and it's elaborated in here. I show how we do this in a number of ways. The link could be by repeating a keyword, and this is the last sentence of one paragraph, the beginning of the next paragraph. It could be by using a synonym, prisoners becomes hostages. It could be by rephrasing a concept, hanging to execution. It could be by personalising a category. We finish with reference to a small-time trader. Here we pick up the particular small-time trader we're referring to. It could be by temporal development. One paragraph ending, he died about 10:30 that same night. Next paragraph, the next morning, Nielsen and now, I'm slightly advantaged here. Being an historian, where storytelling is the mode, it's much easier for me to find examples of this and to use these examples myself. But I'd say this is a really important skill for all of our students to have, because all of them have to become writers. In my view, becoming a good researcher is becoming a good writer. So we also have to equip them as writers. We have to give them strategies for being able to express themselves and to communicate effectively. The last session is controlling your chapters. And here I use a strategy I developed some years ago. And this is why I wanted this space on the floor here. This is the same chapter that I used for the previous exercise I've got here with the 36 paragraphs. You can see that the pages are getting a bit yellowed, so I haven't destroyed too many forests. I keep using the same single pages over and over again. What I've got on the floor here is a chapter disaggregated into its individual components. The chapter is one big 36 paragraph block of text made up of the 36 mini blocks of text. And that's what all the students are producing when they write a chapter. A big block of text made up of smaller blocks of texts. So, there. Now I can be a general. Like, you know, how generals move troops around on the board and so on. The first task in the dot point summary is for the student to identify and highlight the point of each paragraph, just with dot points. So they have to be able to find the point of each paragraph, and here, it's often in the first sentence, a topic sentence, not always. Often it's not even an actual phrase in the paragraph. They might have to extrapolate. But the point is there has to be one point per paragraph. That's the golden rule we use as writers. We know as a reader, when we move on to the next indented bit of text, the next paragraph, we're moving on to a new point. Another example. It's not making exactly the same point as the previous paragraph. This makes reading fairly effortless because we understand the rule. It's like playing cards. If you know the rules of 500 and you're playing, you don't even have to talk because everyone understands what the rules are. And it's the same with the role of the paragraph. We all understand that. Some students don't understand that. So this is a simple technique for them to be able to grasp this rule and be able to effectively communicate. Sometimes they'll come across a paragraph that they've written and they'll look at it and they'll tell me, oh, I can't work out what the main point is. I simply say to them, listen, you're the writer, you're the one who has created this. You can't work out the main point. Imagine how difficult it's going to be for your examiner, for the reader. And it's not even that, because it's not in that person's head. Oh yeah, that's right. I really must make it clear what the point of this paragraph is. Sometimes they'll come across a paragraph and they'll highlight two main points. I'll say, well, how are we meant to read this? Do we read this in terms of this is the point or this is the point? Again, it's confusing for the reader, isn't it? What could you do? And any student, some students actually do struggle a bit, and so he'll say to you, break it up. And she'll say, oh, divide it into two paragraphs. I say, good, that's a good thing to do. Now, that's the beginning. The end might be, or you can see the other questions here. Is the order right? Let's pretend the most dramatic bit This is about the hanging of a young man on Tanner in 1877, right? A really dramatic event. Let's have the chapter building up to this most dramatic bit. In terms of a dramatic bit of writing, in terms of the major point you want to make, let's lead up to this. Let's make a space for it maybe here. Oops, I'm about to do it again, but I won't do it again. So we'll put it in there. Now, this has got implications. This means that we've no longer got the linking between the paragraphs because that one previously had gone to that one back there. But now they know how to go about making links, so they can play around with their text a bit and they can make sure that the end of this paragraph is picked up at the beginning of this paragraph. And the same here, because now they're exercising control over their own writing. So they check, is the order right? Yep. Is anything missing? Oh, I'm working with an assumption there that the reader probably won't know. Maybe I ought to have a paragraph making it explicit what the assumption is. They write another paragraph and they put it in there. Is any point repeated? Well, that point I'm making there really is the same point I'm making here. I need to fix that up. Now, I have my students do this before they give me a draft chapter to read. So they have already exercised quality control over their own writing before I see it. I also tell them, with the draft chapter that you're now happy with, because it's gone through this process that you're giving me to read, give me your dot list points. Because I want to be able to compare what I'm reading with what they think they're writing. They think these are the points they're making, so I'm reading that. Remember, I'm already reading a text which is much better than what we usually get. Paragraphs linked, order right, nothing repeated. They've already thought about what's missing. But when I read this, I can say, oh, I can see what they're trying to say here, but they're not really saying it very well. That tells me, okay, when we meet, this is what I focus on. I don't have to worry about the rest of it, but there are a couple of points here where it's a bit weak. So it's helping me be strategic in the sort of feedback I give to the student. So it's making my job easier, and it's equipping the student to be a better writer. Goes back to where we began. It's equipping the student to be responsible for their own research training, with my help, but they're now assuming greater responsibility. They are becoming independent researchers. It avoids them becoming dependent upon me. It avoids what happened with that professor at La Trobe, where he rewrote everything the students wrote, which was a grave disservice to the students. And then, having got the order right, the student can then ask themselves, well, I know exactly now, I've got an accurate sort of understanding of what all the points are, how it all adds up. Now I know what I need to introduce in the introductory paragraph and what I need to conclude in the concluding paragraph. They might have written a draft introductory paragraph at the beginning, but I say to them, the final introductory paragraph is the last thing you write. You don't know what to write, really, until you've got a sense of what's covered here. Fairly obvious, but again, that's just so empowering for some students, you know, who might start with an introductory paragraph and then they struggle like Cinderella's ugly sisters with the shoe and they end up having to cut off what their toes and their ankle to fit into it. They start off with a model in the introductory paragraph and it just doesn't work for the rest of it. And they're squeezing, they're convoluted, trying to get everything to fit into where they thought the chapter would be going. Now, the benefits to the student are it gives them greater control over the writing process. They can see, often for the first time, what their overall argument is. Now, how often, when we're reviewing our students' work as supervisors, how often do we get lost in it because it's like you can't see the wood for the trees? And it's the same with the students. Often they can't see, well, what's the overall, what's the big story here? I wanted to say, I hit upon this strategy about probably 15 years ago, I'll be very quick. I had a brilliant student, this is Greg Gow, who wrote the PhD thesis on the RMO in Melbourne. Brilliant thesis, won the Vice Chancellor's Award, was immediately published by Melbourne University Press. Great, great contribution to knowledge. Greg Gow was a tech school boy, left school at year 11, became a sort of a youth leader with packs of kids in the western suburbs. Came back, did a community development degree at the end of the third year, went off with his wife to Indonesia and lived in the village for 3 months. Kept a detailed diary, use that as a basis for an honours thesis, which he wrote the next year. He got a Commonwealth scholarship to do a PhD. But he couldn't really write for nuts. And so I was his supervisor. I received one chapter, and it was 79 paragraphs, really long paragraphs, about 100 pages. And it was so convoluted, I kept putting it off. Eventually, I had to read it. I had three teenage kids myself at the time, and I was head of a department. It was almost impossible. I only persevered because I could recognise that there's something brilliant about this person. He's an absolute pain in the ass in terms of the struggle that I'm having, but I can see. If it had been a weaker student, I don't think I would have made this commitment. But I went back to that one idea per paragraph, and I thought, okay, in order for me to understand what he's written, let me try and work out what he's saying in each paragraph. So I started to write, and I wrote, and I wrote, and I wrote the point of each paragraph so that I could work out what he's saying. But some of the things are, for instance, paragraph 17 to 23, needs condensing. I've lost sight of Melbourne Zorimo, whom he's meant to be writing about. Emphasise the key points you make. How do you get from 13 to 24? Your examiners won't map out your argument like this. What are the key points you're wanting to make to get from 23 to 27? Or further down, this paragraph's 34 to 41. It reads like an introduction or a literature review. I wouldn't keep it here. Put it somewhere else. It doesn't belong here. This all points to the problem I indicated at the outset, that is, lack of signposting of the theme or of the whole chapter. What analysis argument are you attempting to construct? Paragraph 42, immediately into another digression. So on and so on, towards the end. The more I think about it, now I'm getting a grasp of what he's saying. This is after paragraph 77, probably a week later, and three bottles of red wine. He's talking here about silencing tactics a community uses against fellow community members. It suddenly hit me. The more I think about it, the more I'm convinced that this needs to be the motif for the chapter, which you call stories of betrayal, conflict, and exclusion. But you keep cutting off the stories. And in so doing, you contribute in your own discursive way to the effective silencing. Now, that struck me because I'd done this technique, and it really was a fairly brilliant sort of point from his point of view. It gave him the opportunity to say something which was fundamentally new. And he said it in a much more theoretically informed way than I ever could. He was much stronger on theory than I've devoted time to. And in the end, as I say, he wrote a brilliant thesis. Going back to, it's a student who decides on the order and the sequence of the points in the paragraph. It's a student who decides on which points need to be emphasised or further developed with my input, but they make the decision. It's they who decide that the text clearly expresses exactly what they want to convey before they give it to me to read. Now that really, I feel that's treating me with respect, as well as equipping them. They're equipping themselves, they're making my life easier, and they're treating me with respect. The benefits to us are that we tend to receive better revised work. It tells us that the student has reflected on what they've written. By having them exercise quality control over their own work, we're encouraging them to be responsible for their own improvement. By looking at that dot point list, we can assess if they are communicating what they think or they're wanting to communicate, and we can focus on working with the student where their intended meaning is in fact not being communicated. Now, this way, we're able to give them better feedback on whether the student is doing all this. It's on the PowerPoint. What it all adds up to, all of these strategies are ways of developing confidence, trust, and mutual respect between the student and the supervisor. The strategies encourage a greater sense of connectedness and professional engagement. It lets us know, with the various strategies, that we are, in fact, addressing the needs being experienced by the supervisors. We're not second-guessing what those needs are. We're giving them space and opportunity to tell us what they need to be helped with, where they need strategies, where they need further direction for reading. It reduces our supervisor workload. Believe me, try it. It'll reduce by 50% the amount of time you have to devote to making sense and being able to give effective feedback on a chapter. And it develops students as independent researchers and writers, which is, and this is a final point, after all, the reason d'etre for completing a thesis. Now, I said I'd leave time for questions, but we're already over time. Are there any questions? Okay, thank you very much.